that in them and in the way is safety.
ثم قال واحذروا رأي جهم واحذروا رأي جهم فإنه صاحب رأي وكلام وخصومات. جهم هذا هو الجهم ابن صفوان رأس البدع الذي نفى علو الله على خلقه وأنه استوى على عرشه كما نطقت به آيات القرآن الكريم وكما صرحت به أحاديث النبي الأمين عليه الصلاة والسلام وكما هو إجماع المسلمين، ولم يخالف في ذلك إلا شذاذ من المتكلمين. فالإمام أحمد يحذر من رأيه، وأهم ما ورد في رأيه أمران، أحدهما هذا من نفي العلو والاستواء والفوقية، والثاني هو ما أشار إليه من قبل وهو نفي كلام الله وأن الله قد خلق القرآن، تعالى الله عما يقول الظالمون علوا كبيرا.
And then Imam Ahmad goes on to say, and wahdhur, be careful and be aware of the right of the opinion and view of Jahmin. For indeed he is a person of opinion and kalam. Kalam being here a thing called scholastic philosophy. And if you don't understand, shall refer back to the books. And of khusumat and of debating. Because if I define every word, inshallah, I'll be adding for the sheikh, so I don't want to. Therefore, this person, Jahmin, he is Jahm ibn Safwan. He is one of the leaders of innovation. And he is the one who negated and denied the ulu Allah, that Allah is high above. And he is the one who denied that Allah is above his arsh. As, and all these two things are pointed to by the book and the sunnah and by the ijma of the ummah, and only those few who debated from them, from the mutakallimun and from the ahl bidah, went away. But the ahl sunnah have an ijma on this matter. And this person, this bidah mubtadi', he said these things, and therefore Imam Ahmad is pointing to the false opinions of this man, Jahm ibn Safwan, in two matters. The first matter, that he negated the ulu Allah, that Allah is high above his arsh. And the second matter, which had been pointed to previously in the text, the matter that the kalam of Allah, the speech of Allah, is not created, but it is his speech.
ثم قال وأجمع من أدركنا من أهل العلم أن من هذه مقالته إن لم يتب لم يناكح ولا يجوز قضاؤه ولا تؤكل ذبيحته، لأن هذه العقائد من أفعال الكفار الذين لم يؤمنوا حق الإيمان بألوهية ربهم وربوبية إلههم، فنفوا عن الله ما أثبته لنفسه ونفوا عنه جل في علاه ما أثبته له رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فكانت عقوبتهم إن لم يعاجلوا أنفسهم بالتوبة والإنابة ألا يناكحوا، أي ألا يتزوجوا مسلمة وألا يتزوج المسلمون منهم وألا يجوز قضاؤهم، لأن القضاء بين المسلمين لا يكون إلا منهم، وألا تؤكل ذبائحهم، لأن من شرط الذبيحة إما أن يكون ذابحها مسلما أو أن يكون كتابيا. أما المرتدون، أما الكافرون المشركون من غير هذه الأصنام، فإن ذبائحهم لا تؤكل جزاء إنكارهم للعقائد المسلمة عند أهل السنة والجماعة ومن كان على منهج السلف الصالح.
And then he goes on to say that Imam Ahmad said, and the people of knowledge that I have met and come across They are united. That anyone who is of these opinions, and he does not make tawbah, then neither do you marry him, or neither do you take from them in marriage. Neither is it allowed to go to them for judgment or for a settlement. And neither is there dhabiha, thing is slaughter eaten from. This is the punishment for those people. Therefore, because these things are from the aqidah of the people of the kuffar, of the actions of the disbelievers, and not of those who believe and are from the people of the qibla. So once you have these beliefs and you do not make tawbah, then it is as if Imam Ahmad is saying that to punish them, if they do not repent, we do not give them in marriage, neither do we take from them in marriage. Because marriage is not done from apart from the Muslims or from Ahl al-Kitab. Likewise, the qadi, judging or settlement. A Muslim only goes to another Muslim for settlement and judgment. And from the dhabiha, the slaughtering of the sacrifices, that we can only eat from a slaughter or sacrifice if it meets two conditions. If it is from a Muslim or from a person of Ahl al-Kitab. And that has tafsil, but the Shaykh didn't mention it and we'll leave it, but you can go back to the scholars for the tafsil. Therefore, these people, because they have left the bounds of either being Islam or either being a Ahl al-Kitab, it is as if Imam Ahmad is saying to punish them and to show them how evil and false their way is, we will not do these things from them.
ثم قال رحمه الله والإيمان قول وعمل يزيد وينقص زيادته إذا أحسنت ونقصانه إذا أسأت. هذه المسألة من مسائل المفاصلة بين أهل السنة والمبتدعة، والمبتدعة فيها قسمان، وأهل السنة فيها هم أهل الحق. أما القسم الأول فهم الخوارج الذين جعلوا العمل، أي عمل أصلا من أصول الإيمان، التارك له كافر، وهذا ضلال عريض. وأما الطرف الثاني فهم المرجئة الذين قالوا إن الإيمان هو التصديق، هو عمل القلب فقط، فأي إنسان كان أكبر العصاة إيمانه كأعظم المتقين، وأما أعمال الجوارح هذه فإنها لا تفاضل بين الناس، وهذا ضلال عريض أيضا. وأما أهل السنة فقد اعتبروا العمل جزءا من الإيمان، عمل اللسان وعمل القلب وعمل الجوارح، وأن الإنسان كلما ازداد من الأعمال الصالحة كلما ارتفع إيمانه، وكلما نقص من الأعمال الصالحة كلما نقص إيمانه، وكلما ارتكب من السيئات كلما نقص إيمانه، حتى لا يكاد يبقى من إيمانه إلا مثقال ذرة. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من سرته حسنته وساءته سيئاته فهو مؤمن. من سرته حسنته وساءته سيئاته فهو مؤمن. أما أولئك الذين لا يرفعون للأعمال الصالحة وزنا ولا يقيمون لها رأسا، فإنهم لا تسرهم أعمالهم الصالحة ولا تحرج قلوبهم أعمالهم التي فيها عصيان الله تبارك وتعالى. فمن قال بأن الإيمان قول وعمل يزيد وينقص، وأن عمل الجوارح جزء من الإيمان، فإنه بريء من أن يكون مرجئا، كما يتقول على عباد الله بعض الجهلة الضالين الذين لم يعرفوا حقيقة هذا الدين، ولم تتملى قلوبهم بنهج السلف الصالحين رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين.
And then the next part of the treatise. that iman is a saying and an action. It increases and decreases. It increases by, or its increasement is by good deeds, and its decreasement is by doing bad deeds or simple deeds. That was the text. And this matter, this mas'ala, is from the masail, from the matters which distinguish Ahl Sunnah from Ahl Bid'ah, from the matters which distinguish the people of truth from the people of innovation. Because the people of innovation have two stances in it, different totally from the stance of Ahl Sunnah. And the Ahl Sunnah have only one united stance. As for the stance of Ahlul Bid'ah, as for the Ahlul Bid'ah, then they have two stances. One which is manifested by the Khawarij, and they are the ones who make actions and a fundamental principle from the principles of Iman. So if you leave it, you become a kafir. And then the second group or second manifestation is by the Murji'ah. And they are the ones who say that Iman is a tasdeeq in the heart, a belief in the heart. And therefore, they are the ones that say that actions do not harm, and that the belief of us does not differ. So the belief of one of you is equal to the belief of one of the most pious one of us. And thus they have said a very even saying, and we know the butlan, the falsehood of these things. But as for Ahl Sunnah, then they make actions a part of Iman. Every time you do good deeds, it increases your faith. And every time you do a bad deed, it decreases your faith. Sometimes you do bad deeds such that only an atom's weight of Iman is left in your heart. And then he quoted a hadith. And I was asked for the pen. Sheikh al-Hadith, what was
من سرته حسنته وساءته سيئته فهو مؤمن.
إيش مقصود بساءته؟
يعني ساءته أي أغضبته وأسخطته.
طيب. And this hadith says, any whoever's time or action is happy, and whoever's any anger is and whoever's anger, his anger is evil, then he is a believer. This is just, we'll go back to him later, inshallah. But anyway, this hadith shows that one's actions go up and down, but you're still a believer. Because it says, huwa mu'minun. And then he says, whoever says that your iman goes up and down, then he's free from the khawarij and free from the murji'ah. Because there are people in this day and age that falsely lie against some people and claim them to be from the Murji'ah. They falsely attribute these things to the scholars in this day and age.
ثم قال ويخرج الرجل من الإيمان إلى الإسلام. يريد أن الإنسان إذا ارتكب بعض المعاصي قد تخرجه هذه المعاصي من مسمى الإيمان، لكنها لا تخرجه من مسمى الإسلام. وفي هذا رد على بعض الطوائف التي ليس عندها إلا مؤمن أو كافر، أما مسلم لم يصل بعد إلى درجة الإيمان فهذا ليس موجودا عندها. وهؤلاء كأنما لا يؤمنون بالقرآن، والله تبارك وتعالى يقول في كتابه العزيز: قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. قال ولا يخرجه من الإسلام شيء إلا الشرك بالله العظيم، إلا الشرك بالله العظيم، أو برد فريضة من فرائض الله تعالى جاحدا بها. هذا كلام الإمام أحمد يتكلم عن الرد وهو الإنكار أو الجحود والتكذيب، فإن ترك يتكاسلا أو تهاونا كان في مشيئة الله، إن شاء عذبه وإن شاء غفر له. فهذا من الإمام أحمد تقرير لقاعدة عقيدة أهل السنة التي يجادل فيها اليوم بعض الجهلة الأغرار وبعض المبتدعة الأغمار الذين ينكرون على الإمام أبي جعفر الطحاوي قوله في عقيدته: ولا نكفر أحدا من أهل القبلة بذنب ما لم يستحله. والاستحلال يكون بالاعتقاد، إما ردا وإما إنكارا وإما جحودا وإما تكذيبا. وكذلك يكون الكفر برد الفريضة، أما إذا كان الترك عن كسل أو تهاون دون إنكار أو تكذيب أو جحود فإن أمره موكول إلى ربه، إن شاء غفر له وإن شاء عذبه، كما هو صريح نص القرآن الكريم: إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء.
At one point, the hadith, JazakAllah khair for whoever did this, yeah? It means whosoever's good deeds please him, and whosoever's bad deeds displease him, then he is a believer. JazakAllah khair. Now, then Imam Ahmad said, and then he says, the text is, a person may leave what is called Iman to that which is called Islam. But he doesn't leave from Islam at all except by shirk in Allah the Most Great. This is the text. And then he goes on to say, so if he leaves it due to laziness or due to not placing significance, or then he is in the will of Allah, the mashi of Allah. If Allah wills, he will punish him, and if he wills, he will forgive him. That was the text. In this, it is shown and shows us that a person may leave what is called Iman and enter what is called Islam, but he still is a Muslim because he has not left Islam until he does that of shirk. And this is a rad, a refutation of some of the deviant groups who only claim and who only have two things. You are either a believer or a disbeliever. A mu'min, am kafir. And this is not the case of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And then, because we know that, and he quoted the verse in Surah Al-Hujurat, that the Arabi said that we have had Iman. But then it was said to them, Allah said, say, you have not believed, but say, we have Islam, that we have entered Islam, or we have Islam. Because, the verse goes on to say, because Iman has not entered your heart as of yet. This is Surah Al-Hujurat. This is a proof to say that one may come from Iman down to Islam, and not what the innovators say. And therefore, this speech and this paragraph from Imam Ahmad is affirming a great principle from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and in it it refutes those who refute some scholars, the likes of Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi in his book, when he says, we do not make takfir of anyone from the people of Qibla because of a sin, if he, as long as he does not make it halal, the sin. What? And then he went on to explain that this thing here, that this tahleel of a thing has differing levels. Because a tahleel of making something halal, istitlal, can either be by three things. Can be by juhud, by denial. Can be by making rad, and and takzeeb, and by rejecting this, and by having a denial. Therefore, this saying of Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi has tafsir, and it is not taken as the people of innovation take it.
ثم قال وأما المعتزلة الملعونة فقد أجمع من أدركنا من أهل العلم أنهم يكفرون بالذنب ومن كان منهم كذلك فقد زعم أن آدم عليه السلام كافر. لماذا؟ لأن آدم عصى الله وخالف أمره في أكل الشجرة فهو على مذهبهم كافر فهم يكفرون الأنبياء. وأن إخوة يوسف حين كذبوا أباهم يعقوب عليه السلام كانوا كفارا لما ادعوا أنه أكله الذئب وجاءوا على قميصه بدم كذب. وأجمعت المعتزلة أن من سرق حبة فهو كافر تبين منه امرأته أي تطلق ويستأنف الحج إن كان حج أي يعيد حجه. قال فهؤلاء الذين يقولون بهذه المقالة كفار لا يناكحون ولا تقبل شهاداتهم، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من كفر مسلما فقد كفر، ويقول من قال لأخيه يا كافر فإنها تصعد إلى السماء فإن وجدته كما قال وإلا حارت عليه أي رجعت إليه. فأمر التكفير أمر خطير ليس الإقدام عليه علامة رجولة ولا علامة شجاعة ولا علامة حق ولا علامة إقبال، وإنما هو والله علامة جبن وعلامة ضعف وعلامة خلو للقلب من الإيمان وخلو للنفس من الصدق ومحبة الرحمن. فليتق الله أولئك الذين يكفرون المسلمين حتى العصاة منهم ذات الشمال وذات اليمين وهم لا يعرفون حق الله تبارك وتعالى عليهم، وكأنما هم أوصياء الله في خلقه على أرضه يفتحون باب الجنة لمن شاء ويغلقونه في وجه من شاء. هؤلاء يجب أن يعلموا أن حق الكفر إنما هو حق من حقوق الله. ولقد قال الإمام ابن الوزير اليماني كلمة رائعة جميلة جدا في هذا الباب، قال إن الخطأ في الحكم بالإسلام أهون بكثير من الخطأ بالحكم أو من الخطأ في الحكم بالكفر. ثم شرح فقال لأن الخطأ في الحكم بالإسلام خطأ في حق الله، بينما الخطأ في الحكم بالكفر إنما هو خطأ في حق العبد. والخطأ في حق العبد مبني على الأخذ والرد على المشاححة، أي أن لا يفوت العباد شيئا، كما قال الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام إن الله يقتص من العباد بعضهم لبعض حتى يقتص للشاة الجلحاء أي التي كسر قرنها من الشاة القرناء أي التي كسرت لتلك قرنها. فالله عز وجل لأن تخطئ بالحكم بإسلام رجل أهون بكثير من أن تخطئ بالحكم بتكفير رجل. لذلك جاءت الأحاديث كلها من كفر مسلما فقد كفر، من قال لأخيه كافر فقد كفر، أيما رجل قال لأخيه كافر فقد رجعت إليه، ولم يأتي في حديث واحد من أسلم كافرا فقد كفر، كلها من كفر مسلما وليس في أي منها من أسلم كافرا. فهذه إشارة إلى أن قضية التكفير قضية خطيرة خطيرة إلا إذا ظهر الكفر واضحا عيانا بينا صريحا لا إشكال فيه ولا شبهة تعتريه، ردا أو إنكارا أو تكذيبا أو جحودا، فحينئذ لا يسكت أهل العلم وعلماء الأمة عن هذا الكافر فيبينون كفره ولا يسكتون عن شركه وضلاله. فحينئذ ليقل طلاب العلم والدعاة إلى الله ما قاله علماؤهم من قبل، أما أن يتجرؤوا على ما لم يتجرأ به أئمتهم، وأما أن يقدموا بتهور على ما لم يقدم عليه علماؤهم، فهذا والله هو الجهل بأبشع صوره وأشنعها.
And then the text goes on to say, and as for the Mu'tazila, the cursed Mu'tazila, for indeed, as with regard to them, the people of knowledge that I have met are united that they, and the Mu'tazila, make takfir, take out of Islam, person for a sin. And whosoever, and therefore any of these people who make this takfir because of a sin, then he has claimed that Adam alayhi peace, Adam alayhi salam was a kafir. And that the brothers of Yusuf, when they lied to their father Ya'qub, peace be upon him, they were kuffar at that time. And we know that the Mu'tazila have united that anyone who steals even a habba, even a grain, then he is a kafir. And his wife should be separated from him. And that he should redo his hajj. For these people, these Mu'tazila, they are the ones who are propounding the opinion of the kuffar. Therefore, you do not marry or take marriage from them, and neither is their shahada, their testification, accepted. That was the text. So again, it is shown that these people, these Mu'tazila, and from those who are the afrakh, the remnants in this day and age, they make takfir or even our prophets if you keep to their principle and their way. Because we know that Adam, peace and blessings be upon him, he disobeyed Allah. When Allah told him, do not eat from this tree, and Shaitan fooled him and he ate from the tree. Read the Quran. And therefore if they say this, they make Adam a kafir. And likewise, the brothers of Yusuf, when they took him out, and they left him in a well, read to Yusuf, they lied to their father. Again, if they say this, then this is what their sayings imply. And we know that this is a great matter. And our Prophet said that whoever makes takfir, whoever makes kufr of a Muslim and declares a Muslim to be a kafir, then he has disbelieved. And also, whoever says to his brother, oh you kafir, then the kufr returns back to him. All these hadith have explanations, inshallah, but we're just quoting the text. These things make saying these things, declaring takfir, is not from the signs of being proud and of being brave and being courageous. It is not from these characteristics at all. Rather, it is from the trait of cowardice, from being a coward. So thus, these people should fear Allah. Should fear Allah from declaring the sinful Muslims to have left Islam. Because it is as if these people are saying that the gates of Jannah are to them. They open and close it to whom they will. And thus they make a person kafir or Muslim as they like. And thus, we know this is not the case. And then he quoted a saying from one of the great scholars, Ibn Wazir, that he who makes a mistake in judging a person to be a Muslim, that is much lighter than one who judges a person to have left Islam and to be a kafir. And then the Sheikh explains this statement of Ibn Wazir, a great scholar from Yemen, and he says that because the right of declaring a person to be a Muslim is the right of Allah, and therefore the judgment in that is easier. Whereas the right, the haq of declaring someone to be a kafir is the haq of the ibad, of the slave. And we know that Allah, and we know that this thing, the right of the servant, leads on to other matters. His mu'amala, his interaction, and his treatment. And then he went on to repeat the same hadith again, you know, about the ones making takfir. So we know that these hadith. Sorry. Then he went on to say that the matter, and pointing to the matter, that the matter of making takfir is a great matter, a very important matter, and it is not allowed to delve into this matter unless you see kufr which is as clear as the sunlight, or towards of those effects, kufr which is clear and manifest. And the hadith are many for this nature. And we know that kufr is of rad, of takzib, of inkar, and of juhud. It would not be right for me to translate these words, because one word has a long explanation towards them. But this is what it entails. Therefore, it isn't just as easy as saying, ya kafir, because kufr has several levels. And this is when we refer back to the books on this matter. And thus, the people of ilm and sunnah, they have clarified that this matter is not for anyone to delve into it. Rather, those who do, it is from the signs of jahal and ignorance. And the Shaykh said many, many other things, inshallah, we can refer back to the tape. Because he's a very powerful speaker, mashaAllah.
حتى لا نطيل عليكم وقد أطلنا كثيرا نريد أن نقرأ بقية الوصية التي حوت عيون عقائد أهل السنة قراءة سريعة لنتممها في هذا المجلس إن شاء الله، ثم نعلق على ما قد يشكل منها تعليقا خفيفا جدا.
Inshallah, we will now suffice by reading the text, because we don't want to prolong it and make it long because of all the lack of time, even though we have made it longer than we willed. So we will read the text, and then we'll make some very slight additions or sharh. So he'll read the Arabic in one go, inshallah, and then I'll try my best, inshallah, to do something.
قال وأما الرافضة أي الشيعة فقد أجمع من أدركنا من أهل العلم أنهم قالوا إن علي بن أبي طالب أفضل من أبي بكر. هذه مقولة الشيعة، تفضيل علي على أبي بكر. قال فقد ردوا الكتاب والسنة لقول الله تعالى محمد رسول الله والذين معه، فقدم الله أبا بكر بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لو كنت متخذا خليلا لاتخذت أبا بكر خليلا، ولكن الله اتخذ صاحبكم خليلا، أي إن الله اتخذ رسوله محمدا عليه الصلاة والسلام خليلا أي حبيبا، ولا نبي بعدي. فمن زعم من الرافض والشيعة أن إسلام علي أقدم من إسلام أبي بكر فقد كذب، لأن أول من أسلم عبد الله بن عثمان ابن أبي قحافة وهو أبو بكر، هذا اسم أبي بكر، وهو يومئذ ابن 35 سنة، وعلي ابن 7 سنين لم تجر عليه الأحكام والفرائض والحدود، لأنه لم يكن ذلك الحين رجلا، وإنما كان صبيا، والصبي غير البالغ لا تجري عليه أحكام الشريعة.
طيب. And as for the Rafida or the Rafida and they are the Shia, for indeed the people that he has come across, the people of knowledge, they are united in saying, or they are uniting in saying that the Shia say that Ali ibn Abi Talib is better or afdal than Abi Bakr. And indeed this has been refuted by the book and the sunnah, and by the saying of Allah, that, and this is the same, that Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, and those with him. For in this verse, Allah has given precedence to Abu Bakr, after the Prophet. And the Prophet, may peace and blessings be upon him, said in a hadith, if I were to take a Khalil, a beloved friend, then I would have taken Abu Bakr as my Khalil, a beloved friend. Walakin, but however, Allah, but indeed Allah has taken the Prophet as his Khalil, as his beloved one, and there is no Prophet after me. So therefore, he who claims Anna, that anyone embrace Islam before Abu Bakr, then he has lied. For indeed, the first to embrace Islam was Abdullah ibn Uthman Atiq ibn Abi Quhah. Ibn Abi Quhafa, and this is the name of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And he, in that day, in that time, was 35 years old, whereas Ali ibn Abi Talib was only a child of 7 years old. And the rulings of the Sharia and of the laws of inheritance and of the hudud were not implemented upon him, to mean that he was so young that they did not apply to him, because he had not reached the age of bulugh, the age of attainment. So therefore, this statement shows the deviancies within these people, and I will not add it anymore. Because Sheikh told me not to add anymore.
ثم قال ونؤمن بالقضاء والقدر خيره وشره حلوه ومره والقضاء والقدر هو ما علم الله عز وجل من عباده ما سيفعلونه بعد أن رزقهم العقل ورزقهم البيان فكتب عليهم ما علم أنهم سيفعلونه. ونؤمن بالقضاء والقدر خيره وشره حلوه ومره، وأن الله خلق الجنة قبل خلق الخلق وخلق لها أهلا، وهؤلاء الأهل هم الذين اختاروا العمل الصالح بعد إن رزقهم الله عز وجل العقل وهداهم طريق الخير وبين لهم طريق الشر، كما قال تعالى وهديناه نجدين، وكما قال تعالى إنا هديناه السبيل إما شاكرا وإما كفورا. قال ونعيمها دائم، ما في الجنة من رزق وخيرات وبركات دائم لا ينقطع. ومن زعم أنه يبيد، أي هذا الخير الذي في الجنة يفنى، فإنه كافر. ومن زعم أنه يبيد من الجنة شيء فهو كافر، يبيد أي ينتهي ويتلاشى. وخلق النار قبل خلق الخلق وخلق لها أهلا، وعذابها دائم، وعذابها دائم. وفي هذا إشارة إلى أن النار لا تفنى، ويفتري بعض الجهلة إذ ينسبون أن ابن تيمية يقول بأن النار تفنى، وكذبوا عليه، فإنه نص في عدة من كتبه أن النار لا تفنى ولا تبيد، وكذلك الجنة.
And then the text goes on to say that we believe in qada and qadr. In English it's like predetermination and pre-estimation is a wrong word, unfortunately. Pre-estimation is the wrong word because I use it. But anyway, it's the decree of Allah, and inshallah will explain it. That we believe in qada and qadr. It's good and it's evil. It's sweet and it's bitter. And that Allah has created Jannah before he created khalq, creation. And that he created for Jannah its people and its bounties and blisses, and that these things are everlasting, da'imun. And whosoever claims that it will finish and end, that Jannah will finish and end, then he, or anything of this nature, then he's a kafir, a disbeliever. And he created, and Allah created, and we believe that he created the nar, the fire, before he created creation. And he created for it, its people. And that this is forever. And then the Shaykh went on to say that two matters, first and foremost, that people have lied upon Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy upon him, when the attribute that he said that the fire will end, rather he has stipulated in many of his books that Jannah and therefore Nar will last everlasting. And also it is a stipulation that punishment of Jahannam will be everlasting.
ثم قال وأن أهل الجنة يرون ربهم لا محالة يعني يقينا قطعيا وأن الله يخرج أقواما من النار بشفاعة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وهذا من رحمة الله بأهل السنة أن معصية الواحد منهم وإن عذب عليها يوم القيامة فإنه ينجو في آخر المطاف بعد أن يمن الله عليه بشفاعة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم فيخرج من النار وأن الله كلم موسى تكليما واتخذ إبراهيم خليلا وفي هذين الأمرين إثبات لصفة الكلام وإثبات لصفة المحبة فهذا عودة من الإمام أحمد في الرد على أولئك الذين يؤولون الصفات صفات الله تبارك وتعالى أو يعطلونها إثباتا لما أثبته الله لنفسه منه رحمه الله وإثباتا لما أثبته له رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم
And then the text goes on to say that the people of Jannah will see their Lord without any doubt. And this is a certain thing. Therefore the people of Jannah will see their Lord. And that Allah will take out a people from the fire, a people from the fire and from Jahannam, due to the shafa'ah, intercession of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. And that Allah spoke to Musa, and he took Ibrahim as his Khalil, as his beloved friend. In these two things is a rad by Imam Ahmad against certain of the innovations. And let's go back to the first matter. That people, that the believers will see Allah in the Day of Judgment. This has been shown by many, many ahadith. The second matter, that due to the shafa'ah, the intercession of our Prophet, people, the sinners and some people who entered fire, will leave fire. And in this is a reputation for many of the deviants again. And likewise, in the two matters when it says that Allah, that he spoke to Musa, and he took Ibrahim as a Khalil, is a rad, and going a bank, and Imam Ahmad going back to the first point of affirming the sifat of Allah, as he did in the initial stages, and refuting the Jahmiyyah, and their likes. In these two things, because he affirms again the manhaj of sifat for Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah by saying that Allah spoke to Musa and he affirmed this without making any of the tahreef of the Ahl al-Bidah.
ثم قال والصراط حق وهو الجسر المنصوب الذي هو أرق من الشعر وأحد من السيف والميزان حق وهو الذي توزن به أعمال العباد وقال الصراط حق والميزان حق لأن بعض الناس من الفرق تؤول الصراط وتؤول الميزان فتجعل الأمر متعلقا بالقبول والرد دون أن يكون هناك مرور على الصراط ودون أن يكون هناك وزن للأعمال وهذا كله رد للنصوص المروية الصحيحة الثابتة والصراط حق والميزان حق والأنبياء حق وعيسى بن مريم رسول الله وكلمته أي أنه المخلوق بكلمة من الله قال له كن فكان نعم
is حق it is real and it will happen and it is a matter of belief and that the mizan, the scales, are haq. And likewise, the word haq means that they are true, they will happen, and they, it is a matter of having iman in. And that the anbiya are haq. And that Isa, the son of Maryam, is the messenger of Allah and his word. And then he goes on to say that this sirat is a bridge which will have to be traversed. It is as thin as a hair and as sharp as a sharp blade. And we know the attributes, we can refer back to the books again for detailed descriptions. And likewise, he said these things are haq because certain people make ta'wil. They falsely interpret these things. And therefore, they do this to say that one will have to cross across the bridge, and neither will our actions be weighed. And therefore, Ahmad ibn Hanbal says, these are haq, these are true, they will happen in a matter of faith. And as for that Isa ibn Maryam is the kalima of Allah, his word, i.e. that he is created by the speech of Allah. When he said, kun fayakun, when he said this word, be and it was, then he was created. This is the meaning.
ثم قال والإيمان بالحوض والشفاعة. الحوض هو الحوض الذي يرده الناس وهو مكان فيه ماء في الجنة. من ورده وشرب منه شربة لا يعطش بعدها أبدا. والشفاعة أي شفاعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وغيرها من الشفاعات الواردة في السنة. والإيمان بمنكر ونكير وهما الملكان اللذان يأتيان العبد في قبره ليسألاه من ربك ما دينك من نبيك وعذاب القبر وهو من عقائد أهل السنة. والإيمان بملك الموت أنه يقبض الأرواح ثم ترد في الأجسام في القبور فيسألون عن الإيمان والتوحيد. وملك الموت هذا اسمه ملك الموت. وأما ما هو مشتهر على ألسنة العامة من أن اسم ملك الموت عزرائيل فإنه لا يعرف في الكتاب ولا في السنة. قال والإيمان بالنفخ في الصور النفخات الثلاث التي ينفخ فيها ملك الصور إسرافيل عليه الصلاة والسلام إذانا بالبعث والحساب والقيامة. والصور قرن ينفخ فيه إسرافيل وهو البوق. قال وأن القبر الذي في المدينة أي المدينة النبوية هو قبر محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم معه أبو بكر وعمر، لأن بعض الشيعة تنكر هذا من غلوها، تزعم أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يمت، يريدون أن يتشبهوا بأهل الغلو، لأن عيسى عليه الصلاة والسلام حي في السماء، ومن علامات يوم القيامة الكبرى أن يرجع إلى الأرض ليحكم بالإسلام ويكسر الصليب. فهم يريدون أن يجعلوا النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كمثل عيسى، ظانين أن هذا يفضل عيسى على محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام. وليس من شك أن رسولنا صلوات الله وسلامه عليه هو سيد ولد آدم، كما قال أنا سيد ولد آدم يوم القيامة. وقال وقلوب العباد بين أصبعين من أصابع الرحمن عز وجل. في هذا الحديث إثبات لشيئين، أما الأول إثبات لصفة الأصبع لله كما يليق بجلال الله، ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير، لا نفكر فيها ولا يخطر على بالنا وصفها. وأما الأمر الثاني فهو أن المؤمن يجب أن يظل دائم الدعاء لله بالثبات، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كثيرا ما كان يقول اللهم يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على طاعتك. وقال والدجال خارج في هذه الأمة لا محالة، أي قطعا ويقينا. والدجال هو المسيح الدجال الذي يبعثه الله من علامات الساعة الكبرى فتنة للعباد، من أطاعه دخل النار ومن عصاه دخل الجنة. وينزل عيسى بن مريم فيقتله بباب لد، وباب لد منطقة في بلاد الشام يقتل فيها عيسى عليه الصلاة والسلام المسيح الدجال. قال: وما أنكرت العلماء من الشبهة فهو منكر. أي شبهة ترد على المسلمين وعلى سنة سيد المرسلين وعلى الدعاة الصادقين وأنكرها أهل العلم وردوها فهي منكرة، لا يجوز أن يبقى لها أثر في النفس ولا يجوز أن تستمر موجودة في القلوب.
And then it goes on to say, we have an imam having faith in the hold. And I read the text first, easier. An imam in the hold and in shafa'a, in intercession. An imam in Munkar and Nakir. These are two names of two angels. And in the punishment of the grave. An imam in the Malak al-Maut, and that is his name. And that the soul, and that he, Malak al-Maut, takes away the soul at the time, or from the body. And then he brings it back to the body again when it is put in the grave. And then these two angels, they ask the body about iman and tawheed. And then we have iman in nafs, and this is the sound which is blown by the trumpet in the sur, which is a horn or trumpet. Oh, that's the most, probably the most closest English word, unless I want to give something. And sur is the book, a trumpet or a horn or something similar to that, which is blown by Israfil, another name of another angel. And that the grave, i.e. the grave which is in Medina, the grave of the Prophet, is the grave of the Prophet. And with him, I beside him, is Abu Bakr As-Siddiq and Umar ibn al-Khattab. And that the hearts of the servant or the slaves are in between the fingers of Allah, the two fingers of Allah, from his fingers of Rahman, mighty and sublime. Next point, that Dajjal will come into this Ummah, and there is no doubt about that. And inshallah. Like, وَيَنْزِلُ and Isa will descend. Isa ibn Maryam will descend and he will kill Dajjal in a place called Bab al-Lud. And we'll come to that again. And that which the scholars have repudiated or censured from the Shubhat, then it is from the evil. Points need to be clarified. The hold is a pond-like thing or lake-like thing, but the word lake and pond, they do not befit a translation. It is a place in Jannah full of water, and the believers who drink from it will never feel thirsty again. And the hadith appendix will refer back to the books. And that the shafa'a refers to the shafa'a, the intercession of our Prophet and other ones shown in the authentic book and the sunnah. And they then talk about that there'll be three blows by Israfil, by which the hour will come. And then he went on to say, because all the details can be looked elsewhere, but inshallah, the shaykh has just been pointed. And also that the hearts of the servants are in between the fingers of Allah. This is a very important matter, because we affirm what Allah has affirmed in His book, and what His Messenger has affirmed upon the tongue, and what Allah has affirmed upon the tongue of His Messenger, without making ta'rif, tahrif, or ta'til, or takayyuf. All these points are referred. And we affirm this in a matter which befits Allah. We do not make resemblance. So be careful when you hear these. Do not go and think we are making tashbih. But Allah has these are from His attributes. And the heart of the slave is in between them. And that, there is a famous dua from the Prophet, in which he said, Ya muqallib al-qulub, O turner of the heart, establish, make thabit our hearts. This is showing that Allah can turn a heart, and we can be upon iman now, and next day leave. Because no one knows when and what people he will die upon. So if upon this is an affirmation of two things, that we establish as sifat of Allah, and we affirm that we should keep on acting in goodness, because we will never know what will happen to us. Two things. And also, that the coming of Dajjal is from the signs of the hour and from the big fitna. And one who obeys him has disbelieved. And Isa will descend and will kill Dajjal in the place of Babalud, and that is the place in Sham. And also, one point the Sheikh mentioned is that certain people, going back to the grave thing, that they deny that the Prophet's grave is in Medina, resembling the Jews and the Christians, or the people who say, that's resembling some of the deviants, when they say that Isa has not died, therefore, if he hasn't died, he's better than our Prophet, therefore our Prophet has not died. These are all falsehood and lies. Rather, the Prophet's grave is in Medina, he's there, and with him is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar ibn Khattab. So this is a refutation of these people, because there's no doubt that our Prophet is from the best, and he's the best of creation. And it's the Shaykh referred to a hadith that the Prophet said, I am the Sayyidul, the best and the most noblest of the sons of Adam. And inshallah, the Shaykh said here, we stop and we suffice with this level, and we will pray inshallah. And whoever wants desires after Salah, whoever wants that, if you desire, we can continue with this for half an hour. Wabillahi tawfiq.
Inshallah. We'll break for Salah, inshallah. And as the Shaykh has been kind enough to say that we'll go for another half hour, inshallah, after Salah. Those who want to go for the half an hour, if they can remain, come straight away and be seated so that we can get cracking, inshallah ta'ala. For those of you who are not remaining, inshallah, can you bear with me for one moment? If you can bear with me for one moment, those who are not remaining, the program, inshallah, in this masjid continues with Sheikh Abdullah Al-Fati, who is here with us and will be giving a lecture tomorrow at 7 o'clock. And again, alhamdulillah, we will have him, the topic will be confirmed tomorrow, and it will be further clarification again of this Aqeedah and Manhaj. Next month, inshallah ta'ala, we have Sheikh Mashhoor coming, inshallah ta'ala, and we will continue to bring the Shuyukh to clear this Aqeedah and Manhaj, as the brothers, sisters, all of us here require it. Jazakum Allah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
To Malik al-Maut, then that is his name. And as for the things which many people, a name which many people give him as Israel, and that is not based upon the Quran, upon the Sunnah, and it is not known. And so I think that will be enough, inshallah. That will be back, inshallah, Sheikh.
ثم قال رحمه الله واحذروا البدع كلها. وهذا القول منه له وجهان من البيان. أما أولهما فهو أن البدع سواء كانت في العقيدة أم في العبادة أم في المنهج أم في الدعوة أم في السلوك، كلها بدع يجب أن تحذر. فليس هناك بدعة تقبل وأخرى لا تقبل، فالبدع كلها من حيث الرد سواء، وإن كان بعضها أشد إثما من بعض. وأما البيان الثاني فهو دفع ما قد يتوهمه بعض الناس من أن في البدعة ما هو حسن، فإن البعض يزعم بأن هناك بدعة حسنة، وهذا مردود، فإن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. فهذه الكليات المتتالية من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم جاءت لرد ودفع مثل هذا التوهم. وقد ثبت عن ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال: كل بدعة ضلالة وإن رآها الناس حسنة. وهناك بعض الشبهات يتعلق بها بعض المحسنين للبدع المزينين للمحدثات من الأمور رددتها في كتابي علم أصول البدع، ولست أريد الإطالة عليكم في هذا الوقت من المساء.
And طيب and then the Sheikh Imam Ahmad goes on to say and be aware of bid'ah, of all bid'ah. And in this statement there is two clarifications, and these two clarifications can be taken from these two aspects. First, that any bid'ah, whether it is in the belief, in the manhaj, in the suluk, in the manners and the way, the etiquettes, in the da'wah, or anything else, whatever the bid'ah is, that every bid'ah should be feared, we should refrain from it, and we should stay away from it, and we should be aware of it. Because whatever the bid'ah is, big or small, they are all rejected. And some bid'ah, some innovation, a bid'ah is an innovation, some bid'ahs are more intent in sin than others. So this is the first point that has been shown by and pointed to by Imam Ahmad. The second point is that there's nothing called bid'atul hasana, a good bid'ah. Although some people may claim that there is a good bid'ah. And this has been refuted by the saying of our Messenger, may peace and blessings be upon him, that the most evil, sharul umur, the most evil of matters are the new ones. And every new matter is an innovation. And every innovation is a going astray from the khutbah, the prayer of need, the khutbatul hajah, the sermon of need. And likewise, the saying of Ibn Umar, may Allah have radiallahu anhu, may Allah have mercy upon him, when he said, kullu bid'atin dalalah, every bid'ah is a misguidance and a deviation, even if the people deem it to be hasana, good. So this is a clear statement by Ibn Umar, one of the foremost from the companions themselves. And there are other matters connected to this thing, to the topic of bid'ah, which the Shaykh has dealt with in detail in his book called this book here, inshallah, which is called The Signs of the Usul of Bid'ah, a very fundamental book for everyone to buy and to read. He deals with all the shubahat, the doubts that people can have. And otherwise, because of lack of time, inshallah, we won't go any further in this matter.
ثم قال رحمه الله ولا عين تطرف بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خير من أبي بكر الصديق. قوله ولا عين تطرف أي ولا يوجد إنسان، والعين التي تطرف هي العين التي ترمش وتغلق وتفتح، وهذا لا يكون إلا من الإنسان الحي المتحرك. كأنه قال لا يوجد حي بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أفضل من أبي بكر، ثم قال ولا بعد أبي بكر عين تطرف خير من عمر، ولا بعد عمر عين تطرف خير من عثمان، ولا بعد عثمان بن عفان عين تطرف خير من علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنهم. ثم قال هم والله الخلفاء الراشدون المهديون. فهذا التفضيل هو التفضيل الذي اتفقت عليه كلمة أهل السنة، وأما سواهم من المبتدعة فإنهم قد يقدمون أحدا أو يؤخرون آخر بما لا دليل لهم عليه إلا التعصب والرأي والهوى. قال وأن نشهد للعشرة أي العشرة المبشرين بالجنة من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأن نشهد للعشرة بالجنة وهم أبو بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وطلحة والزبير وسعد بن أبي وقاص وسعيد بن زيد وعبد الرحمن بن عوف وأبو عبيدة عامر بن الجراح. هؤلاء هم العشرة الذين قال فيهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أبو بكر في الجنة وعمر في الجنة وعثمان في الجنة وعلي في الجنة إلى أن سردهم جميعا رضوان الله تعالى عليهم. ثم قال: ومن شهد له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالجنة شهدنا له بالجنة. في هذا إشارة إلى أن هناك آخرين غير هؤلاء العشرة المنصوص عليهم في الحديث الواحد أنهم من أهل الجنة، كمثل ذلك الصحابي عكاشة ابن محصن الذي سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في ذكر 70,000 يدخلون الجنة بلا حساب ولا عذاب، قال: يا رسول الله ادعو الله أن أكون منهم. قال: فأنت منهم. فقام آخر وقال: يا رسول الله ادعو الله أن أكون منهم. قال: سبقك بها عكاشة. وأما الأمر الثاني الذي يستنبط من هذا القول الأخير له قوله: ومن شهد له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالجنة شهدنا له بالجنة، هو أن لا نقطع لأحد مهما كان صالحا ومهما كان في الظاهر تقيا أنه في الجنة إلا لمن شهد له الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. لذلك حتى كلمة شهيد لا يجوز أن تطلق إلا في من وردت فيه السنة بالإطلاق عليه. من أجل هذا بوب الإمام البخاري في صحيحه بابا قال: باب لا يقال فلان شهيد. ومع ذلك نسمع كثيرا من الناس يخالفون هذا الهدي ويناقضون هذا الحكم، فيوزعون ألفاظ الشهادة: الشهيد فلان، وفلان في الجنة، وفلان مع الأبرار، وفلان تزوج من الحور العين، وهكذا. فإن كان ولا بد فليقل الواحد: إننا نحسبه عند الله كذلك ولا نزكي على الله أحدا.
And going on, proceeding with the text, he says, and there is no eye which flickers and closes apart after the Prophet, who is better than Abu Bakr. I'll stop here because this needs clarification. There's no eye which open and close means that there's no person, because only the humans and whatever, their eyes close and open, and the living again, because the dead, the eyes don't close or open. So it is an indication that there's no living person around who is the best after the Prophet apart from Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. I.e. Abu Bakr Siddiq is the best of creation after the Prophet in his time. So it goes, there's no eye that closes and flickers after the Prophet's one who's better than Abu Bakr ibn Siddiq. And none after him, no eye which closes and flickers better than Umar ibn al-Khattab. And none better than after Umar ibn al-Khattab than Uthman ibn Affan. And none after Uthman ibn Affan than Abu Ali ibn Abi Talib. May Allah have mercy upon them all. And then Imam Ahmad says, whom, and by Allah, they are the Khulafa Rashidin, they are the rightly guided Khulafa. And he goes on to say, and we witnessed for the 10, and in the 10 people pointed to by the Prophet in a hadith, that they are in Jannah. And who are they? They are Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha ibn Zubayr, Sa'id ibn Abi Waqqas, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, Sa'id ibn Zayd, wa Abdul Rahman ibn Auf. Zuhri. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf al-Zuhri, and Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah. And then the next point, and all these will be dealt with shortly. And whosoever the Prophet has testified, may Shahada, that he is from Jannah, then we make the same testification. So this has several points. That first of all, we believe that the best person after the Prophet who was alive at his time and from then onwards is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And then who? Umar. And then Uthman. And then Ali. This is the order. This is the belief. This is what Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah have made ittifaq upon. Have made united agreement upon. And this is, as for the people of Bidah, if they have any different ordering, then it is based upon no dalil but their own desires and own machinations. But and as for the 10 which have been quoted to you, then their thing has been established upon a hadith in which the Prophet said that Abu Bakr is in Jannah and Umar is in Jannah and Uthman is in Jannah until he named all of these 10 people in one hadith. But this, and also going on in the last part, that we testify for he whom the Prophet has made this shahada that he's in Jannah, points to two things. That there are also other people for who the Prophet made this certification. From them, Uqashita ibn Mihsan, one of the Prophet's companions. And the hadith is a very long hadith. The hadith about 70,000 people will enter paradise without any hisab. The famous hadith. And upon hearing this, at the end of the hadith, Uqashita stood up and said, "Oh Messenger, make dua that I am from them." And the Prophet said, "Yes, you are from them." And then after hearing this, another man stood up and said the same thing. But the Prophet said, "Usam Uqasha has beaten you to this." So this is dalil, this is proof, without any doubt, that Uqasha is from the people of Jannah. And dalil that there are other people. And there are other evidences quoting other people elsewhere. Second point shown by this last phrase is that we do not affirm with absolute surety that so-and-so, however righteous he may be, however pious we think he is, and however righteous deeds he does, that he's from Jannah. Because this is not for us to do. And therefore, when many people say, or use the word, shaheed, and so-and-so is a shaheed, fulan is a shaheed, or so-and-so has married a hurr al-ayn, or things of this nature, then this is all wrong. This is not from the aqeed of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Rather, we should say, we think he is from the people of Jannah. It's better, because we do not have this guarantee, this seal of approval, even from the hadith or from the kitab, from the book. And therefore, and when we say this, we say fulan, we think he's from the good people or from Jannah, and we say we do not praise anyone more than Allah has praised him or given him this lofty status.
ثم قال رحمه الله ورفع اليدين في الصلاة زيادة في الحسنات. رفع اليدين عندما نقول الله أكبر الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده، رفع اليدين زيادة في الحسنات، يريد بذلك الرد على من جعل رفع اليدين في الصلاة من العبث، وأن رفع اليدين فقط في تكبيرة الإحرام، فأنكر عليه قائلا ورفع اليدين في الصلاة زيادة في الحسنات. ثم قال والجهر بآمين عند قول الإمام ولا الضالين، لأن بعض المذاهب لا تجهر بالتأمين وتعتبره أيضا من الأمور التي تخدش في الصلاة وتمنع من كمالها. قال والصلاة على من مات من أهل هذه القبلة وحسابهم على الله عز وجل، أي الصلاة على من مات من أهل القبلة حتى ولو كان عاصيا ولو كان فاتقا، طالما أنه لا زال في دائرة الإسلام ولا زال في دائرة لا إله إلا الله وأهل لا إله إلا الله. وأما منزلته ودرجته وموقعه ومآله فحسابه على الله تبارك وتعالى. قال والخروج مع كل إمام في غزوه وحجه والصلاة خلفهم صلاة الجمعة والعيدين، يشير في ذلك أو بذلك إلى بعض الناس الذين يرفضون أئمة المسلمين من وولاتهم وخلفائهم لأنهم واقعوا شيئا من المعاصي وخالفوا شيئا من أحكام الشرع، فمن كان وليا لأمر المسلمين وإماما من أئمتهم طالما أنه لم يظهر منه كفر بواح ولا ردة صراح فإنه لا شك ولا ريب يجب أن يستمر على الولاء له وعدم تكفيره أو الشهادة له بالشرك والردة، بل وجوب الخروج معه في الغزو والحج والشهادة وشهود الجمعة والجماعة والعيد معه. وهذا رد على الخوارج وأشباههم وأفراخهم في كل عصر وفي كل زمان.
And then Imam Ahmed goes on to say, and raising the hands in the prayer, the Sheikh showed us, I don't want to go into the same thing, but raising the hands in the prayer, when you say Allahu Akbar, when you go down into ruku and up from ruku, raising this hand is from increasing your good deeds. And I'll stop here, I'll do point by point. Because there are people, and this is a rad, a refutation against those who say raising a hand is from the abath, from the nonsensical, foolish things, and it has no benefits. This statement by Ahmed ibn Hanbal is a refutation against them, saying that it is a good thing because it is from the increasing of the hasanat. And likewise he says, and jahru bil ameen, and he's saying ameen aloud in the prayer after the imam says wala dhalin, this is also from the same matters, from the hasanat. Again, because likewise the people, they say the same thing, that it is only from, you know, the abath, the nonsensical and the foolish parts of the prayer. Therefore he's in his statements refuting these people, because there are some people and some madhahib, some sects and groups and schools of thought who say these things. And therefore this is Imam Ahmed's clear statement that these are good deeds and he's refuting them. And then he says, and salat upon, and he gives salah and dua and whatever upon those who die from this people of this qibla, i.e. the people who pray to the qibla in Makkah, i.e. the Muslimun, the Muslim. Then we make salah, we make dua and istighfar for them. Because as long as he has remained a Muslim, this is permissible. And as long as he is a person of Islam, and a person of the kalima, that he says, none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, then this is due to him, and this is one of his rights, and so forth. And then he says, and his hisab, his account is to Allah, i.e. we make this dua to him, for him, sorry. We make this dua for him, to Allah, we ask Allah to forgive him. But as for his status, as for where he is, then that is to Allah, we do not know, we do not judge. Rather that is to Allah, and Allah will take account of him. And then he goes on to say, وَالْخُرُوجُ مَعَ كُلِّ إِمَامٍ, and therefore going out with every imam, every leader, imam him is leader of a people, and fighting with him, and making hajj with him, and praying behind him, the Eid prayer, the normal prayer, and the Jum'ah prayer are from the matters of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And this is pointing to the fact that there are some people who refute and who deny that this matter, that you can pray behind a leader who is sinful, or they stop doing this if they see a sin from him or something, you know, because every man is sinful, but if they see a sin from him, from the leaders, then they stop and they do not go out and fight with him or fight the battles of jihad or whatever with him. They do not make hajj with him. Rather, Ibn Ahmed is saying that you have to do this, this is from the ways of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Rather, we do this until he leaves Islam, and he can only leave Islam when he manifests openly without any doubt kufrun bawah, kufr in which there is no doubt about it.
ثم قال والكف أي الامتناع عن مساوئ أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, أي عن الأمور التي تسيئهم وتسيء إليهم, وبخاصة في الفتنة التي جرت بين الصحابة أو بين بعض الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم, بأن يقال هذا كذا وهذا كذا, هذا في الجنة وهذا في النار, هذا على هدى وهذا على ضلال, هذا لا يجوز. لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إذا ذكر أصحابي فأمسكوا, أي قفوا ولا تتكلموا ولا تخوضوا في هذه الفتنة. ففتنة نزه الله عنها أسلحتكم فنزهوا عنها ألسنتكم. ثم قال تحدثوا بفضائلهم, كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام لا تذكروا هلكاكم أي موتاكم إلا بخير فإنهم قد أفضوا إلى ما قدموا وأمسكوا عما شجر بينهم، أي اسكتوا ولا تتكلموا عن الفتن والخلافات التي كانت بين بعض الصحابة، فكل له أجره وكل له اجتهاده وكل له حكمه عند الله تبارك وتعالى. ولقد صح عن علي رضي الله تعالى عنه وهو الذي كان في وسط بعض هذه الفتن أنه قال عن الصحابة الذين كانوا يقاتلونه وهو صحابي وهم صحابة، قال قتلانا وقتلاهم في الجنة. وما هذا إلا لأنه يعلم أنهم جميعا يريدون الحق ويريدون الصواب ويريدون الدين، وإن أخطأ بعض منهم الطريق لعذر وسبب إن ظهر لبعضنا فإنه قد يخفى على الأكثرين.
Before I read the text, there's one point I missed out, and that this matter of not going to do jihad and etc. with the imams is still around, and this is a feature of the Khawarij and their remnants who are around in this day and age and in many numerous countries. Going back to the text now. And also, refraining from matters which may harm or which may be seen as being harmful upon the companions of our messenger, peace and blessings be upon him. And also, remember, and this is one thing, we refrain from this. And we mention them and their virtues. And we keep quiet about that which happened between them. These are very important matters. Because he says, we do not talk about that which, anything which happened between them and the evils and the sins, because In particular to the fitna, the trials and tribulations that happened amongst them, to the companions, and because we do not say such and such is right and such is wrong and such is Jannah. Rather, the way, because it's not allowed, لا يجوز, as the Shaykh said, but rather follow the hadith of the Prophet when he said, if a companion of mine is mentioned, then keep quiet, keep your mouth quiet. And he went on to mention this hadith. We can refer back to the books for this. And also we know the many, because this hadith has been mentioned in more than 10 different, in many different versions. Anyway, going on, he says, but mention them with their good. And he pointed to another thing, quoting that a hadith or so, that said, do not mention your dead except by in good deeds or in goodness. So again, our companions have passed away. It's not allowed to mention them apart from in that which is good. So it is important that we keep quiet about the fitna, the trials and the problems, that the ikhtilaf that happened between the companions. Because if we do talk about this, we'll be delving into that which is haram and not allowed from us. Because, and it is authenticated from Ali ibn Abi Talib, and he was one of the companions who was around at that time. And he said about the companions who were, and the people who were involved in the fitna, he said, they're deceased, and the ones they are deceased are killed in this fitna, and they're killed are in Jannah. And he only said this because he knew that each of them was seeking the haq and looking for the haq. There's nothing else in them. But nevertheless, if they did err and they didn't find the straight path, then that was due to a shar'i udhr, an excuse which is from Islam for them. Whereas this matter may be clear to one of us, but rather it was unclear to them, and therefore they are excused, and that they are in Jannah. And therefore we are refrained from talking about these things. And here we can refer back to this point in a book called The Book of Creed by Barbahari. This is not what the Sheikh said, but this is in English with many of these points there. It is very important that you refer back to that book.
ثم قال رحمه الله ولا تشاور أحدا من أهل البدع في دينك ولا ترافقه في سفرك. هذه عودة من الإمام أحمد رحمه الله إلى الرد على أهل البدع والتنفير عنهم والدعوة إلى اجتناب طريقهم وألا يكونوا أهل شورى للسنيين ودعاة السنة وأهلها، وألا يكونوا مرافقين لأحد
من الذين رضوا بالسنة إماما وبالسلف الصالح قدوة، لأنهم عندهم الخير كله، فمن كان عنده هذا الخير فلماذا يجنح إلى سواه ولماذا يذهب إلى غيره وهو أقل منه بكثير، بل لا يكاد يلتقي معه لا بقليل ولا بكثير.
And proceeding, Imam Ahmad goes on to say, I do not seek consultation from any person from the people of innovation in his deen, and neither be his companion in his travel. The Shaykh is saying that this is a return to the initial part when he said, and beware of all innovation, and a return to the initial part when he was warning from the innovation. Because in this part, he's a warning and he's telling us to stay away from the people of innovation by doing these two matters. Therefore, this is clarifying the manhaj of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, such that the people of Sunnah do not take the people of Bid'ah as consultants or make them or ask them for advice. Neither do you travel with them then make one of them your leaders and that affect you, because he who has the likes of the ulama of the Salaf as their leaders, who has the guidance of the Kitab and the Sunnah from the Salaf, then he's in no need of these people.
ثم تطرق رحمه الله إلى بعض من المسائل الفقهية التي قد ينحرف عن الصواب فيها بعض من الناس، بل التي انحرف عن الصواب فيها بعض من الناس، فقال: ولا نكاح إلا بولي وخاطب وشاهدي عدل، لأن كثيرا من الناس يتساهلون في هذا فيظنون كما يظن الذين لا يؤمنون بالله ولا باليوم الآخر أن المرأة أو أن البنت إذا صارت امرأة وبلغت 18 أو أقل أو أكثر صار أمرها في يدها، فيجوز لها أن تزوج نفسها من شاء من تشاء كيفما تشاء، وهذا لا يجوز، لأن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: لا نكاح إلا بولي وشاهدين. ثم قال: والمتعة حرام إلى يوم القيامة. هذا رد منه على الشيعة والروافض الذين لا يزالون إلى هذه الساعة يستمتعون بالنساء في الحرام زاعمين أنها من الدين وأنها المتعة، والمتعة كانت في أول الإسلام ثم نسخت إلى يوم القيامة، ونفر عنها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونهى عنها أصحابه، ونهى عنها أئمة العلم، بل إنه قد ورد عن الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله أنه قال: المتعة زنا. ثم قال: والتكبير على الجنائز أربع، فإن كبر خمسا فكبر معه. قال ابن مسعود: كبر ما كبر إمامك، أي بقدر ما يكبر إمامك في صلاة الجنازة فلتكبر معه.